بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. I testify that there is no true God worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is Allah's true slave and messenger. May Allah salam and salam be upon the noble prophet, the believers of his family, and the noble companions, and those who follow on their path until the day of resurrection. This is part two concerning the subject on the qualities of Umm al-Mu'mineen, Aisha, the mother of the believers, Aisha. May Allah be pleased with her and her father. As you heard in part one, Aisha got married to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam when she was 9 years of age. This matter is taken by the enemies of Islam as a means to slander and speak ill about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Saying that he alayhi salatu wasalam got married to children. We know that the commencement of the marriage took place when she was 9 years of age. And from their slander is that they accused the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam of uncontrolled sexual desires. But the fact is that, number one, had this been the case with respect to the enemies of Islam at the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, who stood up in opposition to Islam and who would have loved to find in that element an excuse to refute the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and to nullify the honor of his character, they would have used this matter against the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. However, the fact that they had no problem with it, and the news of this marriage was just like any other news, and they didn't denounce this marriage at all. In fact, they knew before that she was mentioned before marrying the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Her name was mentioned for engagement with Jubair bin Mut'im bin Adi. How could they even deny that when they knew well that she was not the only young girl getting married at that age to an old man, and she was certainly not the last one? How could they deny that when they knew that Aisha was growing physically like many of her young age from the Arab girls in their times? Something which prompted one of the Orientalists to speak fairly after he visited the Arabian Peninsula. And this Orientalists is boldly in his book Ar-Rasul, the Messenger. He, when he checked this matter, he said that some historians looked at this from the angle of the contemporary societies they live in. They didn't even put into consideration that this was even a habit in Asia. They didn't even think that this was still going on in Eastern Europe, and that it was even natural in Spain and Portugal only till recently. So from these angles, this matter is refuted, and the stressing on it by some only reflects hate, and when that is the case, then take off your hands, because you can deal with that in a rationalistic matter with them. This is the first point from the side of those who are filled with hate against Islam and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in particular. From another angle, there is even, and this is something some of you may not even imagine, there is even worse than the accusations of those who don't ascribe to Islam. There are those who claim Islam from the deviant rejectionists, the Rafida, who went to what can be easily described as unbelievable slander against al-Mu'mineen Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her and her father, reflecting even deeper hate. Against the Siddiqa, the truthful one, the daughter of As-Siddiq, the truthful father, and the beloved one, the daughter of the beloved one, the pure, declared innocent from above seven heavens, Aisha, who occupied the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's heart in love. And whom the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam described that the divine inspiration never came to him while he was under the blanket of any of his wives except Aisha. And on that he said, don't trouble me by harming Aisha. For by Allah, the divine inspiration never come to me while I was under the blanket of any woman amongst you except Aisha. As in Sahih al-Bukhari, volume 5, hadith number 119. Aisha. His wife in this life and his wife in the hereafter, as in the authentic hadith reported in al-Bukhari. Aisha, whose saliva mixed with the Prophet's saliva, during his death, Aisha, who cared for him during the agonies of death with his head, alayhi salatu wasalam, leaning against her chest, the beloved one, may Allah be pleased with her. Those rejectionists hate Aisha. This is exemplified in their harm and in their accusation of her in a matter which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared her innocent of in verses recited until the day of resurrection. They claimed that Aisha is kafir and that she is from the dwellers of hell. They even twisted the Quran to conclude this. Take for example what they did to Surah An-Nahl, chapter 16, verse 92, regarding the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ولا تكونوا كالتي نقضت غزلها من بعد قوة أنكاثا. And be not like her who undoes the thread which she has spun after it has become strong by taking your oath a means of deception among yourselves, lest a nation may be more numerous than other nation. They twisted this and they said that this hair here refers to Aisha, turned away from Iman to Kufr. Yet this is an example, a parable is given concerning a woman. Spunning and then undo the thread. This is in reference to the breaking the oaths and the covenants. And this is in their books like Tafsir al-Ayashi and Bihar al-Anwar lil-Majlisi. And they claimed that Aisha has a special door to hell where she will enter through in Al-Burhan lil-Bahrani and Bihar al-Anwar lil-Majlisi and Tafsir al-Ayashi. They said that concerning the verse in the Quran in chapter 15, verse 44, describing hell, لها سبعة أبواب. Hell has seven gates. For each of those gates is a special class of sinners assigned. they said that the sixth door is for Askar, and Askar is a nick for Aisha to them, as mentioned by Al-Majlisi in his Bihar Al-Anwar, volume 4, page 378, and volume 8, page 220. Not even to this extent, but even worse, they called Aisha Umm al-Shurur, the mother of evils, as in the book As-Sirat al-Mustaqim lil-Bayadi, volume 3, 161. And also he called her Ash-Shaytana in the same reference, volume 3, page 135. And they claimed that she used to make lies against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As in the book of Al-Usul from Al-Kafi, their reference, Al-Killini, volume 1, page 247. Aisha to them was kafira, not from the people of Iman, and that she is from the dwellers of hell, even having a special door. The sixth door to hell is specific to Aisha, wal-iyadu billah. Aisha, whom Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, when he entered her apartment while she was in death, he told her, كنت أحب نساء رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إليه. You were the most beloved of the women of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. To him, meaning to the Prophet. عمار بن ياسر, may Allah be pleased with him, once heard a man speaking ill of Aisha. He scolded him and deterred him and told him, turn away from me, despicable. أتؤذي حبيبة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, you harm the beloved to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And this is in جامع الترمذي. And At-Tirmidhi said, هذا حديث حسن. This is a good hadith. And in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he was asked, who is most beloved to you from the people? He said, Aisha. And then from men, he said her father. And then he named Umar to be next, and then named others after that. And after all of that, those rejectionists claimed that she was kafira. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم spoke of her superiority. He said, فضل عائشة على النساء كفضل الثريد على سائر الطعام. The superiority of Aisha over women is like the superiority of the thareed to other meals, and the thareed is considered the best of meals, bread and meat. their claim that she is kafira is refuted by the saying of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib, may Allah be pleased with him, that إنها لزوجة نبيكم في الدنيا والآخرة, she is the wife of your prophet in this life and in the hereafter. So they even are in opposition of the one whom they claim as their imam. She is a pure believing mother. They continue even after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared her innocence, they continue to slander her of committing the fahisha. They did that not just by mere saying, no, but even through a way whereby they changed the Quran. They took the verse in Surah Al-Tahrim, chapter 10, verse 10, chapter 66, verse 10, في قوله عز وجل ضرب الله مثلا للذين كفروا امرأة نوح وامرأة لوط كانتا تحت عبدين من عبادنا صالحين فخانتاهما فلم يغنيا عنهما من الله شيئا وقيل ادخل النار مع الداخلين. Allah sets forth an example for those who disbelieve. The wife of Nuh and the wife of Lut, they were under two of our righteous slaves, but they both betrayed their husbands by rejecting their doctrine. So they, Nuh and Lut, benefited them, their respective wives, not against Allah. And it was said, enter the fire along with those who enter. Al-Qumi, the infamous of the rejectionists, said that فَخَانَتَاهُمَا, he said this is nothing but fahisha, illegal sexual intercourse. And they said that this refers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will establish the punishment upon Aisha. Because to them she, quote, she committed illegal sexual intercourse and married Talha. And that the parable that is given in this verse refers to Aisha and Hafsa. And that she was in love with Talha, and that Talha wanted her for himself. والعياذ بالله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give the example here concerning the wife of Nuh and the wife of Lut as examples for Aisha and Hafsa, may Allah be pleased with them both. But this is an example set for all the kuffar. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in the beginning of the verse, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Allah sets forth an example for those who disbelieve. And because of their hate against Aisha, and because they believe that she is kafira, they restricted the example to her and Hafsa. None of the Mufassireen from Ahl Sunnah mentioned that the betrayal is a betrayal of sexual nature. Rather, this is a betrayer in religion by rejecting the doctrine. As in Tafsir Ibn Kathir and in Jami' al-Bayan lil-Tabari and Fath al-Qadir lil-Shawkani. And in this is the saying of Ibn Abbas, the interpreter of the Quran, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, who said, مَا زَنَتَا. They, the wife of Nuh and the wife of Lut, did not commit zina. Rather, they mentioned that he was majnun, madman. Imra'at Nuh mentioned about him that he was a madman. And as to the betrayal of the Lut, the wife of Lut, she used to tell her people, informed her people about his guests, those who came in the form of men from the angels. There is no doubt that this story by the rejectionist is fabricated. And it should be known that slander against Aisha, accusing her of fahisha, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared her innocence, is considered an exit from the fold of Islam. And insulting her in this respect is kufr. And this is the consensus of the Muslim scholars, taking as evidence from Surah An-Nur, chapter 24, verse 17. يَعِظُكُمُ اللَّهُ أَن تَعُودُوا لِمِثْلِهِ أَبَدًا إِن كُنتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah forbids you from it and warns you not to repeat the like of it forever if you are believers. Muhammad bin Zayd bin Ali bin al-Husayn, the grandson of al-Husayn, the brother of al-Hasan bin Zayd. When a man from Iraq came and mentioned Aisha in a bad way, he hit him until he killed him. When it was mentioned to him, this is from our people, he said, this insulted my grandfather, meaning the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and anyone who does so shall be killed and deserves to be killed. شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله anyone who slanders Aisha after Allah سبحانه وتعالى declared her innocent فقد مرق من الدين then he exits the fold of Islam as in his book الصارم المسلول page 568 وقال أهل العلم anyone who slanders her is belying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that which he informed about her innocence and anyone who belies Allah then commits kufr and that it is not sufficient that he be whipped because he belied 17 verses in the book of Allah as we mentioned in part 1 that came in Surah An-Nur Al-Karki Al-Majlisi from the infamous of the rejections They curse Abu Bakr, they curse Umar, they curse Uthman, they curse Muawiyah, they curse Aisha, and they curse Hafsa, and Hind, and Ummul Hakam, the sister of Muawiyah. In fact, they say, and that our creed, quote, is to be innocent from the idols, the four idols, Abi Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Muawiyah from the men, and from women, the four women, Aisha, Hafsa, Hind, Ummul Hakam, and from all of their followers, and that they are the evil of creation on the face of the earth. This is related by Ibn Babawayh al-Qummi and he related the consensus of the rejectionists on this. And the one who is called As-Saduq from them, he said, وَنَعْتَقِدُ فِيهِمْ أَنَّهُمْ أَعْدَاءُ اللَّهِ And that we believe that they are the enemies of Allah and His Messenger. And that no one's belief will be completed, no one's belief will be completed, meaning no one's belief in Allah and His Messenger and the Imams, quote unquote, except after declaring oneself innocent and disassociated from their enemies. And who are the enemies? Those we mentioned earlier. This is in the book by Al-Hidayah للصدوق قاف 110 and وحق اليقين by Al-Majlisi page 519 so they curse Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Muawiyah may Allah be pleased with all of them and disassociate themselves from them and they curse the daughter of Abu Bakr, Aisha and the daughter of Umar, Hafsa and declare themselves innocent from them and they claim that they and their followers meaning Ahl Sunnah are the worst evil on the face of the earth everyone knows that Abu Bakr wa Umar wa Uthman is the best and that the daughter of Abi Bakr wa Umar wa Aisha from the best the rejectionists also claim that Aisha and Hafsa, may Allah be pleased with them, poisoned the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, that they conspired with their fathers and made him drink the poison, and that this was the cause of his death عليه الصلاة والسلام according to their lines. And they take as evidence, look what they take as evidence, they take the Quran as evidence. Let us see. They take Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 114 to conclude this. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلًا قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. They believe in Allah on the last day, then enjoin al-ma'roof and forbid the munkar. Maybe this is the incorrect quotation.
بسم الله الرحمن.
It should be 144. 144, please. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is no more than a messenger. And indeed, many messengers have passed away before him. If he dies or is killed, will you then turn back on your heels as disbelievers? One of the rejectionists, Al-Ayashi, he said, do you know what this verse means? It means that he was poisoned before he died. They, meaning referring to Aisha and Hafsa, they were the ones who gave him the poison. Al-Kashani added to this in his book Tafsir al-Safi, volume 1, 305, يعني المرأتين, and then he cursed them. والعياذ بالله. This means the two women, and he cursed them, and he cursed their fathers. And we said, he quote, he said, and we said that they and their fathers are the worst of creation. This is in this Ayashi's Tafsir, volume 1, page 200, and As-Safi Al-Kashani, volume 1, page 305, and Bihar al-Anwar al-Majlisi, volume 6, page 504. Many of their authors related this story, and they named Aisha and Hafsa and their fathers explicitly, and that they were the ones who put the poison to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he died as a result. In Tafsir al-Qummi, in As-Sirat al-Mustaqim lil-Bayadi, in Sharh Nahj al-Balagha libn Abi al-Hadid, in Ihqaq al-Haqq lil-Tastari, and many a fabricated story. Against whom? Against the ones whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam testified for them to be from the people of paradise, and he died while pleased with them, عند الصحابي الجليل عمار بن ياسر، may Allah be pleased with him and his father, and أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب، may Allah be pleased with him, and عمار بن ياسر، may Allah be pleased with him. Swear that Aisha أم المؤمنين is the wife of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in this life and in the hereafter. Aisha and Hafsa from the most beloved of the wives of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and their fathers from the most beloved of men. And the one who points in the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام is Al-Labid bin Asam, Al-Yahudi, the Jew. You can tell, even there are matters which I did not discuss concerning their slanders, but sufficient is what has been mentioned. And if it tells anything, it tells that even the hatred of these rejectionists far exceeds those who ascribe not to Islam from the Kafirs. Last point. We know that Aisha and Khadija are from the mothers of the believers. May Allah be pleased with them all. As to who is more meritorious, Aisha or Khadija, the people of knowledge differed. Some said that Aisha, some said Khadija, and the correct position is to say that their rank with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not for us. This is to Allah alone. As to the preference between them in regard to that which appears to us from their actions and their situations in this life, then this is a matter apparent, known. As to them being wives of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, then there is no preference. All the wives of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام share this merit that they are his wives in this life and the hereafter, and that they are the mothers of the believers, and that we must respect them and magnify them. So now we have the following angles. The first angle, Aisha and Khadija being wives of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. In this case, there is no preference because all the wives of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم share in this merit, being wives of him. Second angle, from the as to the rank with Allah عز وجل, then there is no preference here, because this is unknown to us. And the best as to what is said concerning this, their preference in what is apparent, is that Khadija has the excellence of early admittance to Islam and excellence in supporting the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in the very beginning. And that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to mention her a lot, and that he didn't marry another one when she was alive. And that she was the mother of most of his children. عليه الصلاة والسلام. Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, in her being the most beloved of the wives of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and caring for him, and of her intense love of him, and in her dissipating, in her propagating the great knowledge in the Ummah, in this regard she is more distinct than Khadija. So she gets the merit from this angle. So one has the merits from one angle and the other has the merits from another angle. And this is the correct position, inshallah ta'ala. This brings the end of this discussion on the qualities of Aisha radiallahu anha, as well as refuting the hatred and slander by the enemies of Islam and or the deviant rejectionists, and clarifying some other aspects related to the matter. I ask Allah the Most High to make of this discussion a benefit for myself and for everyone who listens to it. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.